Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Spell to Tell by Lucy May, narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Chapter 1. Are you ready for this? I asked Daphne, taking several calming breaths. She smiled. Girl, I've been ready for the last 3 months. I didn't think this moment would ever come. I don't think I realized how much work would be involved just to get the place transformed into a bakery. I thought it would be a few ovens and sinks and then some seating in the dining room. This has been gobs of work. Smiling, I looked around the tiny dining area of our new bakery. Today was our grand opening. I was nervous and excited at the same time. You've got the cash drawer in? I asked, going through a mental checklist. Yes. Tables are cleaned, condiment bar stocked, display ready. I mumbled as I spun around. Everything had to be just perfect. We're good, Violet. This is going to be great. There's already buzz around town after our soft opening last week. This is going to do fabulous. Are you ready? On the heels of another breath, I closed my eyes and composed myself. Okay, I'm ready. Hit it. She flipped the switch on the neon open sign, and we were officially open for business. We both stood in the center of the dining room, staring at the front door. Daphne burst out giggling. I don't think there's going to be a stampede. I laughed with her. No, probably not. That was a little anticlimactic. Another giggle from her as she walked behind the counter, taking her position at the register. Was it like this at your other bakery? I shook my head. Not really, but I was opening in a larger city on a busy street. There had been a lot of buzz before we opened. The first few days we were slammed, and then things tapered off. Fortunately, after a month or so, business picked back up and steadily increased. It took people a while for word to travel. So many cafes and other stores had been in that same space, no one took us seriously at first. Tara is going to do great. She seemed pretty excited to take over full time, she said, referring to my manager for the bakery I'd left behind when I moved. Yeah, she'll be fabulous. She's been my assistant for over 2 years. She's more than ready to run the whole show. I couldn't close it. That store was my baby. I nurtured it for so long, I couldn't let it go. Daphne flashed a grin. Now you're officially a chain. I laughed. I don't know if two bakeries make a chain, but you're a part of that chain as well if they do. Divine desserts will soon be in every city, Daphne teased. Yeah, let's not get ahead of ourselves, I warned. We both stood behind the counter, waiting for our first customer. I knew the risks of opening a business in a small town, but Daphne was confident we could do it. It wouldn't be a booming business, but I was certain we could make it profitable. I was actually looking forward to the slower pace a small-town bakery would offer. I was completely at peace with working 8-hour days instead of 12 or more. When the first customer walked through the door, we both froze. Hi! I finally greeted the elderly man who was scrutinizing the cookies in the case. Can I offer you a sample? Daphne volunteered. The man studied the assortment of cookies and finally settled on a baker's dozen of chocolate chip cookies. Daphne rang him up while I restocked. That was kind of intense, I whispered to Daphne once the man was gone. He didn't look happy, like we forced him to come in and buy cookies. That's just Grumpy Gus. Don't you remember him? She asked. My eyes widened. He's still alive? That made her giggle. Yes, he's still alive. He's the town grump and clearly not ready to give up his role anytime soon. I nodded in understanding. Gus had been old when I was little. That made him close to a relic now. It had been so long since I'd seen him, I hadn't recognized him. The little bells over the door jingled again. We looked up to see my mother coming through the door. She glanced around the empty bakery before her gaze made its way to us. tension lining her features. Slow start? It'll pick up. We've only been open 5 minutes, after all. People may not even realize we're here yet, I explained, hoping to calm my own nerves as well as Daphne's.
Well, it's good no one's here.
I need to talk to you, both of you, she said, flicking her eyes between us. What's up? I asked, assuming it was something to do with the coven.
There's been a theft, she announced.
Daphne and I looked at each other and then back at my mother. A theft? She nodded her head, looked back at the door, and then leaned over the counter.
At the museum.
Lemon Bliss has a museum? I asked in bewilderment. My mother rolled her eyes. Oh, good grief, Violet. Do you remember anything from growing up here? I looked to Daphne for help. You know, the old museum? It's really an old house. There isn't too much in there, just stuff that showcases the history of Lemon Bliss, she explained. Oh, I said. With her prompt, I recalled visiting the place when we had been in grade school. It was small and only open a day or two a week. It wasn't exactly a main tourist attraction.
What was stolen?
Daphne asked. My mother ran one of her hands over her black hair, her bracelets clinking as she smoothed back the stray strands that had fallen loose from the knot atop her head.
Several items, but two are of serious concern for us. There will be a coven meeting tomorrow night to discuss the issue, she said in a low voice.
Mom, there's no one here, I reminded her.
I know that,
she shot back, her irritation evident. Daphne reached out and squeezed my mother's hand.
We'll be there. I'm sure it will be fine. There's nothing to worry about.
If only that were true,
she muttered as she stepped back from the counter. Do you want a donut or a muffin? I asked, hoping to nudge her mind off of her worries. I never quite knew how seriously to take my mother. She tended toward dramatic, only occasionally were her theatric reactions justified.
No, thank you. I need to talk to Lila.
I'll see you girls tomorrow, and good luck with your grand opening. I'll be sure to pass along the word that you're open and ready for business, she said, waving as she walked out. The sound of charm bracelets jingling followed her out the door.
That was weird,
Daphne said once the door fell closed behind my mother. Virginia's not one to get worked up about anything. I shrugged a shoulder. She's still on edge about the death of that supernatural investigator in the factory. She's been waiting for the other shoe to drop for months. I keep telling her we're fine and there's nothing to worry about, but she is convinced she senses something coming.
Well, I think your mom might be someone I would trust in that department,
Daphne said, her brow furrowing.
I just hope it isn't another murder.
We were interrupted when another customer came through the door, followed by a steady stream of people for the next couple of hours. The sales depleted many of the cookies and muffins, which meant it was time to start baking. I loved baking and was more than happy to leave the front of the bakery to Daphne while I put on my apron and got to work.
Hey, she popped her head in the kitchen a while later. Hi, how's it going out there?
She shook her head.
Ever get what you asked for and then regret it?
I chuckled as I carefully filled muffin cups with batter.
Yep, pretty busy out there. We're almost completely wiped out of cookies. I just sold our last blueberry muffin as well.
I nodded and pointed to a cooling rack filled with blueberry muffins. Those are ready to go. There are peanut butter cookies in the oven, and I'll get started on chocolate chip as soon as I get these in the oven, I replied, entirely in my element. Daphne nodded and carried the muffins out to the front. I could hear the bells jingle and knew another customer was coming in. That was definitely a good sign. I spent the next several hours baking muffins and cookies and fielding questions about the specialty cakes we were offering. Daphne managed to secure several orders, mostly for birthdays and one anniversary cake.
I could feel the strain on the day's business getting to me and couldn't wait to get home and put my feet up. "Can I kiss the cook?" A deep voice cut through my thoughts just as I was slicing through a pie crust. I smiled and turned to face Gabriel Trahan. "There you are." I stopped by earlier, but poor Daphne looked like she was overwhelmed. I figured I'd come back when things had slowed down, he said, leaning in and giving me a quick kiss. "It's been busy." "Here, I thought you could use this," he said, handing me a cup of coffee from Crooked Coffee, my favorite local coffee shop in Lemon Bliss. "Thank you. Daphne is still planning on moving forward with her coffee shop plan," I laughed. "She may change her mind after today." "She looks like she might be getting tired. Are you guys going to hire any help?"
"That's the plan, but we wanted to see what we needed. This first month, it will just be the two of us. My mom and her friends have offered to help if we need it. Considering how busy we are on a Tuesday, I think we may need them for this Saturday," I said, sliding a tray of cookies into the oven.
"I'm here for you as well. I may not be as pretty as the ladies, but I can sell a donut or two," he said with that familiar grin that never failed to send a curl of warmth through me.
"We might take you up on that, which means you might live to regret it," I countered with a wink. He chuckled.
"I'll let you get back to work. I just wanted to stop by and tell you good luck, but I don't think you need it. I'll call you tonight and you can fill me in on the rest of the day," he said, giving me another quick kiss before slipping out the back door. I sipped my coffee, savoring the rich flavor and the kick of caffeine. I could have used a second wind, and this might do the trick. I still had tons of baking to prep for tomorrow. We were definitely going to need to hire an assistant. I could keep up for now, but I certainly didn't want to work at this pace forever. "I'm so tired. I'm going straight home, crawling into a hot bubble bath and drinking a glass of wine," Daphne said as she came through the kitchen door.
"Are we closed?" I asked in surprise. She nodded.
"It's 4. We're officially done for the day."
"Oh, now it's time to clean up," I said with a wink.
"Oh, no. You're kidding, right?"
I shook my head.
"We can't leave it looking like this. It won't take long. You take care of the front, and I'll finish up back here."
She was mumbling as she headed out.
"Who thought this was a good idea?"
"You did," I shouted. Despite the physical exhaustion, I was charged with energy. The day had been hectic, but I thrived on the adrenaline rush. I knew it wouldn't always be like this. I wanted to cherish the moment, even if I was so tired I could barely stand. I'd reluctantly returned to Lemon Bliss, Louisiana, for what I thought would be a temporary visit several months ago. In short order, I'd learned I was a witch, descended from generations of witches, gotten caught up in the investigation of a suspicious murder at the defunct lemon tea factory I'd inherited from my grandmother, and reconnected with a few old friends. I'd come back to my hometown with no intention of staying, only to discover I didn't want to leave. Hey, I had witchy things to learn. Plus, my old bestie Daphne persuaded me that Lemon Bliss was in need of a bakery, and we were the ones to make it happen. It was a win for our official opening day to be a success. I took one last look around the kitchen and declared it was clean and ready to go tomorrow morning. I was going to come in early and get a head start on the baking.
"Ready?" I asked Daphne, who was stocking napkins at the counter.
"Yes, let's get out of here." We walked out together, locked up, and went our separate ways. We were both too tired for chit-chat. As I walked to my car, I thought about my mother's visit and how upset she had been. I hoped it wasn't anything serious. I didn't have the time to worry about another threat to the witches in Lemon Bliss.
Chapter 2.
It was too early. Mere months ago, rising with the sun at the crack of dawn was such a habit, I managed it even when I was tired. Since I'd moved to Lemon Bliss a few months ago, I'd gotten out of practice. Seriously out of practice. This morning, I had to force myself out of bed. Now that Daphne and I had opened the bakery, I needed to get back in the swing of things and fast. My eyes were still a little blurry as I stumbled out of the house and headed for my car. I was meeting Gabriel at Crooked Coffee before I headed for the bakery. We didn't open for customers until 8. That gave me plenty of time to get a few things started before any customers arrived. Despite my half-awake haze, just the thought of baking made me smile. I loved to bake. Even though I'd had my doubts about it, now that we had opened the bakery, I was thrilled. My world had been turned inside out a few months back when I came to Lemon Bliss for what was supposed to be nothing more than a visit. Ha! My visit had turned into much more. I might have been tired, but I was glad Lemon Bliss was home once again, and even more so that I was back to baking. Rolling my car to a stop in front of Crooked Coffee, I glanced up at the massive oak tree that had been split down the center and grown crookedly as a result. Shaking my head, I chuckled to myself as I turned to go into the coffee shop. All those years, I'd thought lightning split the tree. I couldn't have guessed it was a witch's spell gone awry, but then I also couldn't have guessed I was a witch back then either. "Good morning," Gabriel said with a smile as I slipped into the chair across from him. "I already ordered for you." With an appreciative smile, I curled my hand around the warm cup of coffee and took a sip. I loved caffeine, seriously loved it.
"Thank you,"
I said with a sigh as I set the cup down. I don't think I could have handled waiting even a minute longer.
"Did you get some sleep last night?"
"I did. I have a feeling today is going to be busier. I hate to drink and run, but I need to get over to the bakery in the next half hour or so," I explained, feeling a little guilty for rushing out the door.
"When are you going to hire some help? Both of you looked worn out yesterday."
I laughed. "Is that a nice way of saying I looked awful? You really need to work on your game. That's no way to woo a woman."
Gabriel's mouth hitched to the corner as he winked.
"I don't need to woo you, I have you."
I felt my cheeks heat, but I rolled my eyes. Gabriel was too charming for his own good. "Maybe so, but at least pretend I didn't look terrible yesterday." His grin widened.
"Of course not. You just looked busy and tired, that's it. I take it as a good sign. Day one and y'all were busy."
I couldn't help my own proud smile. "We'll see how the first 30 days go, and then we'll talk about hiring some help. We can't spend money we don't have. It could all dry up today or tomorrow," I said.
"I love it when you talk business."
That deserved a full eye roll. "Okay, thanks for the coffee, but I've only got a few more minutes."
"No worries. How's your mom? I saw her yesterday, and she looked like she was worked up about something. Is everything okay?"
I sighed. "I don't know. She was in a tizzy. I guess someone broke into the museum and stole some stuff. I don't know why she's so freaked out about it, but I'm supposed to meet her tonight." He slowly nodded his head.
"I heard about the break-in, but I didn't think it was a big deal."
"I don't see how it can be, but she certainly thinks it is. Needless to say, Daphne and I have been summoned to another meeting tonight."
"Oh, one of those secret witch meetings I'm not supposed to know about?" he asked with a grin.
"Shh, they'll kill me if they know you know. I could get ousted or flogged or have some crazy spell cast on me. I don't know what witches do to other witches." He shrugged a shoulder.
"I think they all know I know, but like to pretend otherwise. Don't forget, Aunt Coral is one of the old guard witches," he said, referring to his aunt.
I laughed at the absurdity of our conversation. It was rather ridiculous to be having coffee and chatting about witches. I forgot we even had a museum in Lemon Bliss. Have you ever been? I asked him.
Nope. I guess it never really interested me.
I chuckled and nodded my head. I haven't been there since elementary school. If I remember right, there are some antiques and papers and whatnot from the settling of Lemon Bliss. I know my family donated some stuff. Maybe my mom's upset because a family heirloom was taken, I reasoned.
He didn't look convinced. I don't know. Aunt Coral seemed pretty rattled by it as well.
I didn't get a chance to say any more.
How was opening day?
Sheriff Harold Smith said, materializing beside our table. Glancing up, I found him peering down at me. The man had an intense way of looking at me. I tended to feel as if something was out of place whenever he did. I self-consciously ran a hand over my hair.
It was great, I replied, taking a sip of coffee to mask my nervousness. The dust had only recently settled from the accidental death in the lemon tea factory. During the sheriff's investigation of that, he'd kept me under the microscope the entire time, certain I knew something about my mother and her friends that he didn't. Of course, he was right. It just wasn't anything about the death in the factory. It was the fact they were all witches, the lot of them, myself included. With a mental shake, I kept my attention on him.
Suppose you heard about the trouble over at the museum?
He asked, his tone stern. Exchanging a glance with Gabriel, I looked up to find Harold's eyes boring into me once again. Clearing my throat, I found my voice. My mother mentioned it yesterday.
Know anything about it?
He asked. No, I don't. I've been pretty busy the past several weeks trying to get a business off the ground, I said tersely. Gabriel gave me a warning look that told me to cool my jets.
If you hear anything, I'd appreciate you letting me know. You might overhear something in your little bakery,
he said, his eyes holding mine. The urge to roll my eyes was overwhelming, but I fought it, knowing it was early and I was cranky. I had only managed to get half a cup of coffee in my system. I'd need a lot more than that to deal with an interrogation. I was weary of his snooping around and his thinly veiled insinuations about my involvement with the accidental death at the factory.
I'll be sure to keep my ears open, I replied politely.
With another glance between us, he nodded.
Thanks,
he mumbled, spun around, and headed out the door.
It was then I noticed that he hadn't even bought a coffee.
That was weird, Gabriel whispered.
He's been acting strange for a couple of months now. I always feel like he's watching me. It creeps me out.
What's creeping you out, dear? Lila said, pulling up a chair and sitting at our table. It had taken a bit, but I was getting used to the complete lack of privacy in Lemon Bliss. It was a small town to begin with, but throw in my mother and her nosy friends, and I could be almost guaranteed to have them show up wherever I happened to be. It wouldn't be a visit to the Crooked Coffee if someone didn't intrude on our quiet time together.
Sheriff Smith, Gabriel answered. He's practically been stalking Violet.
Lila shook her head. He's been watching all of us a little too closely. It's just weird, I mumbled.
Don't worry about it, and don't let him make you nervous.
If you're nervous, you're more likely to slip up, she lectured. Gabriel caught my eyes with a barely perceptible grin. Checking his watch, he announced it was time for him to go. He had a job in Ruby Red and would be out of town all day. He promised to call when he got back. As soon as Gabriel left, Lila leaned in close.
You'll be there tonight? She whispered.
Yes. I don't have a choice, do I? She shook her head.
No, this is important.
Is anybody else worried about Harold? I asked. The look on her face told me all I needed to know.
It is definitely worrisome, but I think I have a plan.
What are you going to do, Lila? I asked, afraid to know the answer. She released a long sigh.
I'm going to cast a love spell.
What does that mean?
I'm going to cast a spell to make him fall in love with me.
I gasped, Lila! She shrugged a shoulder as if it was no big deal.
The spark is already there. It always has been. I'm just going to fan the flames a bit.
Isn't that violating some rule? I asked, shocked she was considering such a thing.
It's for the good of the coven.
How?
If Harold is in love with me, he'll be blinded to everything else. He won't be suspicious about who we are because his focus will be on me. I'm taking one for the team.
She grinned. Besides, I've always been fond of Harold. Do the others know? I asked, knowing my mother would likely not agree with her plan.
I've told them my plan. They may not totally agree, but they know it's the only way to get the man to back off. He's like a dog with a bone. He won't let that business at the factory go. He's been snooping around, and it's getting dangerous. We all need him to cool off a bit.
I'm not going to argue with you there. I came home last week, and he was at the house. He was just sitting in his truck, staring at Grandma's flowers. It was very weird, I told her. I shuddered, thinking of the scene. It had been very unnerving, and it wasn't like I could call the cops and report that the sheriff was sitting in my driveway. Thankfully, he had left almost immediately. He had offered the excuse of wanting to see the flowers, but it didn't sit right with me. My spidey sense had been tingling. I was beginning to trust that sixth sense a lot more now. I figured perhaps the fact I was a witch gave it a little more oomph. My mother swore it did. She shook her head in disgust.
I blame that silly man George, whatever his name is. He needs to go away and leave us all alone,
she said, referring to one of the supernatural investigators who'd been interested in the abandoned lemon tea factory bequeathed to me by my grandmother. Definitely. I can't say I'm happy to hear what you have to do, but I think you're right. It might be best for everyone. How long do you plan on keeping Harold under your spell? She waved a hand in the air.
I don't know. I guess until things settle down a bit.
I have no business telling you what to do, but please be careful. Y'all have me a little freaked out about the repercussions of doing a spell. I don't want you to suffer any kind of negative consequences, I said with sincerity. She was grinning.
Sweetie, we may have oversold the whole repercussions thing. Don't you worry about me.
Just be careful.
I will.
I've got to get to work, Lila. Please be careful if you do go through with your plan. I'll see you tonight, I promised her, standing and getting ready to leave.
I will. Keep your eyes and ears open. Things are about to get a little wild for us all, she warned. Be cautious.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.